looking for a sign to make sure we don't have too many more people who are waiting outside to come in.
About 10 more.
About 10 more, okay. Well, we'll let them come in, and then we'll get underway. We good? Good? I think we're good. I'm going to declare that we're good, whether the folks around the technical folks tell me we are or not. I'm going to get underway. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome. Thank you for spending a little bit of a beautiful spring Madison day inside with us for this fantastic event. As you know, this event is part of a wonderful week here on our campus. And that is the celebration of the investiture of Chancellor Mnookin. And there are lots of events and a new flavor of ice cream, which will be revealed at some point in the next 48 hours, I think. But anyway, it is my pleasure to introduce someone who really does not need an introduction, as my notes have demonstrated, Chancellor Mnookin, who joined us in August as the 30th chancellor of the University of Wisconsin, and joined us from the University of California, Los Angeles, where she was dean of the law school. And it has been a real wonder, a pleasure for me to be able to work with her over these past few months, over the course of this academic year. And it's a pleasure to be part of this investiture ceremony. And so without any further ado, Chancellor Mnookin.
Thank you so much, Dean Wilcotts. Can everybody hear me? Yes? Great. Excellent. Thank you so much, Dean Wilcotts, for that nice introduction and for moderating today's panel, and also starting next week for serving as interim provost.
Week after. Week after.
I think it's a week from, I think it's in a week. Right? Might be a week and a half, but there you go. Anyway, I'm really very excited to welcome all of you to this event today. And yes, it is an investiture event. And if you want some more investiture engagement, you've got a few options. You're welcome to live stream the ceremony tomorrow or at any time thereafter if you're so inclined. But then at noon on Library Mall, there will be a party. And you can get things, including a new ice cream flavor there. So 12 to 2, it should be a lot of fun. Until then, it's a secret, but people are guessing, and maybe some of those guesses are right. So there you go. Over the next 90 minutes, we're really going to have a wonderful panel. I'm very excited about this. We have a panel of really tremendous speakers, and all of whom are trained to think, we might say, a little bigger than just the rest of the world. They go beyond our world. Whether they're hunting for supermassive black holes at the center of our galaxy and elsewhere, or opening a new window on the universe via the South Pole, or searching distant solar systems for the precise chemistry that could sustain life, astronomers have a vision that really is breathtaking in scope and helps us understand more about our universe and about what it means to be human. When we exhort someone to reach for the stars or talk about high-risk, high-return projects as moonshots, we're tapping into a sense of boundlessness and curiosity and opportunity. And I kind of think that is also pretty quintessentially Wisconsin. This university has made significant contributions to astronomy, and that speaks to our vision, our engagement with curiosity-driven research, our willingness to invest in excellence, and our commitment to supporting the frontiers of science. UW-Madison scientists were there for the first measurement of starlight. We made the first recording of radio waves from space, and we're now catching neutrinos thrown at Earth from a cosmic source to shed new light on the origins of the universe. And so when we talk about the Wisconsin idea and our impact beyond the borders of our campus, I mean, we often mean that like about the state and our contributions to the state, or about kind of practical ways to improve life for people. But it's also awesome and important to recognize that part of this Wisconsin idea is about curiosity-based research that helps us understand the universe and ourselves better. And there are people in our midst pushing that line beyond our planet, beyond our solar system, and way into the galaxy. And we get to hear from them today. Now, two of our speakers are UW-Madison people, and Eric will be talking about them and introducing all three of our speakers. But I do need to give a special welcome to one of our speakers here today, a renowned astronomer who also, I'm proud to say, is a very good friend, Andrea Ghez. Andrea is, I'm not going to do her formal introduction. I'm going to leave that for Eric. But I'm going to tell you a little bit about her and about how we met. We know each other from UCLA, where we were colleagues for a good long time. And I'm going to tell you how I met her, because it actually links to a chancellor, although not me. I was not. We had a new chancellor at UCLA. And he was doing a set of sessions with some small groups of faculty members. And both Andrea and I were, I don't know why we were invited exactly, but we were both invited to be part of a lunch of about 10 people or so, I would say. We might have been the only women in the room. I'm not 100% sure of that, but I think it's possible. And we had a wide-ranging lunch conversation about the university and its directions. And I walked out of that lunch saying, she's somebody I'd like to get to know better. And luckily for me, she walked out of that lunch saying the same thing. And so we went and grabbed coffee, and then we discovered that our kids went to the same school in different grades, and then we discovered that we knew other people in common. And after that, she became one of my very closest friends. And so as I've been meeting sometimes with groups of faculty, I've said to them, you never know, but you might meet somebody in this room who becomes a lifelong friend. It's possible, I know, because it happened to me. In fact, when Andrea won her Nobel Prize in 2020, I was lucky enough, this was the middle of COVID, and so she couldn't have the kind of proper celebrations that she deserved, but I was lucky enough to be part of a very small group of people where we got to pop open a bottle of champagne in her backyard. I'm not sure we were completely 6 feet apart the way the rules of the time would have said we should be, but we kept it small, and we raised a glass to her and to the incredible work that she's done. And so it's both a professional pleasure and a deep personal pleasure that she's here today and part of this panel. Our other speakers are also terrific, and Andrea also has an array of professional accomplishments, a few of which you'll probably hear about, but I wanted to share sort of my personal story and connection with her. I'll now turn it back to Dean Wilcotts, who also is an accomplished astrophysicist in his own right. He studies the evolution of galaxies and leads our involvement in the South African Large Telescope, which is helping to discover galaxies a billion times too faint to be seen with the naked eye. So you are in for a treat today, and thank you all so much for being here, and thank you to our incredible panelists for being part of today and the celebration of UW that is this Investiture Week. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, Chancellor Manuka. Everybody can hear me loud and clear? Oh, in the back? Perfect. So again, good afternoon. Welcome to this great this panel discussion about discovery, past, present, and future. And for me, it's a real privilege to join this panel and to be able to moderate this discussion. And before we get too far along, I do want to introduce the panel that sits before you. Professor Andrea Ghez is a professor of physics and astronomy, the Lauren B. Leichtman and Arthur E. Levine Chair in Astrophysics, and head of the UCLA Galactic Center Group. She is one of the world's leading experts in observational astrophysics, perhaps best known for her groundbreaking work on the center of our galaxy, which has led to the best evidence to date for the existence of supermassive black holes. She has received numerous honors and awards, including the Nobel Prize in 2020, where she became the fourth woman to be awarded the Nobel Prize in Physics. The Nobel Prize was awarded for the independent discovery of a supermassive compact object, now generally recognized as a black hole in the center of the Milky Way. Andrea earned the Crawford Prize in Astronomy from the Royal Swedish Academy of Science. She's the first woman to receive that prize in any field. The Bakerian Medal from the Royal Society of London, and she is a MacArthur Fellow. She was elected to the National Academy of Science, the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and the American Philosophical Society. She's also very committed to the communication of science to the general public and inspiring young girls in science. Her work can be found on many public outlets, including TED, Nova's Monster of the Milky Way, Discoveries Swallowed by a Black Hole, and the Griffith Observatory. Andrea earned her bachelor's from MIT in 1987 and her PhD from Caltech in 1992, and she's been on the faculty at UCLA since 1994. Immediately to her right is Frances Halzen, the Vilas Research Professor and Gregory Bright Professor in the Department of Physics here at UW-Madison. Frances is the principal investigator of IceCube. He's a Vilas Research Professor and a theoretician studying problems that span the particle physics, astrophysics, and cosmology. In 1987, Frances started working on what was then called the Amanda Experiment, a first-generation neutrino telescope at the South Pole that represented the proof of concept for the IceCube Neutrino Observatory. Halzen also serves on the advisory committees for the SNO Telescope Array and the Auger Upgrade Experiments, the Max Planck Institutes in Heidelberg and Munich, and the ICRR of the University of Tokyo, the U.S. Particle Physics Prioritization Panel, and the APEC Particle Astrophysics Advisory Panel in Europe. Dr. Halzen received his PhD in physics from the University of Leuven in Belgium. And to his right is Susanna Widicus Weaver. She is the Vozza Professor of Chemistry and Astronomy here at UW-Madison, and she conducts research in the emerging fields of prebiotic astrochemistry, where she investigates the chemical mechanisms in space that lead to the development of biological systems. Simply, the goal of Dr. Whitaker's Weaver's research is to interrogate how life may have formed with the evolution of planets. Her research draws from the forefronts of laboratory spectroscopy, observational astronomy, and chemical modeling. It is only through this type of fully integrated research, combining spectroscopy, observations, and modeling, that a clearer understanding of the mechanisms driving interstellar chemistry and the pathways for the formation of life will occur. Dr. Whitaker's Weaver received her PhD from Caltech. So that's our great panel that we have for you, and we're going to turn to that panel in a few minutes. But I would like to set the stage just a little. In 1927, that is the year that a young man named Karl Jansky graduated from the University of Wisconsin-Madison, having majored in physics. He was also inducted into the Phi Beta Kappa Honor Society, and as a bit of a side, that tradition continues today, and actually Saturday, we will be inducting the next generation of students into Phi Beta Kappa. Karl Jansky was, according to his biography, the fastest skater on the Wisconsin hockey team. I have not checked the records. I don't know how many physics majors we have had on the hockey team since Karl Jansky. We can check that. But he was a member of the hockey team. And there you see him on the left, wearing his Wisconsin sweater. Karl Jansky spent a year working on a master's degree, which he was to be awarded a few years later, before moving to New Jersey in 1928, where he joined the staff of Bell Telephone Laboratories as a member of the radio reception branch. And there he spent the next few years trying to understand the sources of static and radio interference. His work compelled him to build the contraption you see on the right, which is a rotating radio telescope. And he built that there on the site in Hilldale, New Jersey. He did that in order to be able to look for radio signals from across the entire sky. Because again, he was trying to understand sources of static and radio interference. And at that time, of course, Bell Labs was trying to pioneer transatlantic radio communications. So what were the sources of static that Karl Jansky was able to detect? Well, he was able to isolate radio emission coming from local thunderstorms. He was also able to detect radio emission coming from more distant thunderstorms. But despite his efforts there, he was not able to fully identify all the sources of noise that he detected. There was a definitive but faint, persistent signal. And it took several years of work and collaboration with a colleague of his at Bell Labs to try to isolate and figure out where this noise was coming from. Because it didn't behave like the other sources of noise. And so after a couple of years, determined that that noise was coming from the direction of the constellation Sagittarius. And by the late 20s, the astronomical community, through work that had happened a few decades earlier, had determined that the center of the Milky Way galaxy in which we live was in the direction of the constellation Sagittarius. And so Karl Jansky's work, and through his observations, concluded that there was radio emission, radio signals, coming from the center of our galaxy. And that effectively started the field of radio astronomy. Now, his discovery was so impressive and so important that the New York Times itself put this discovery on the front page, May 5th, 1933. You see the headline there. New radio waves traced to center of the Milky Way. Mysterious static, reported by K.G. Jansky. This is the front page of the New York Times. About 11 days later, on May 16th, this is the one I really like. Radio waves heard from remote space sound like steam from a radiator. That's great. And this is really neat, because at the time, folks could figure out how to listen to this, and it made it available to the public to listen to the radio signal coming from the center of the Milky Way. Now, you might be curious, on May 5th, 1933, again, that was on the front page of the New York Times. Other headlines of that issue of the New York Times included, Roosevelt asks for pay rise for workers. And there's another headline I saw, British demanding tariff safeguards. And there's also on that same front page, troubling news from Japan and Germany. So this was on the front page of the New York Times in 1933. So Karl Jansky, Wisconsin class of 1927, revealed that the center of our galaxy is a very interesting place indeed. But it would be many, many decades before we will be able to confirm just how interesting the center of the galaxy is. And to carry on our story, let me turn things over to our first panelist, Andrea Ghez. Andrea. Thank you.
It's a real pleasure to be here today and to join this celebration of Chancellor Mnookin in her leadership. And I just thought I would share a few stories. Actually, the one I thought I would begin with was the one you already heard, which is how we met when our chancellor at UCLA was brand new, gathering faculty to think about the future directions. And the wonderful thing about service at that level in the university is you get to meet people across campus. And when you find people of kindred spirit, you think, I definitely want to continue this conversation, which, as you heard, we did. Another story I thought I would share, because actually I've learned a tremendous amount from Chancellor Mnookin over the years about not only how to succeed in the university, how to become and develop as a leader, but also how to become a good mom. So we've shared many stories. So in fact, when I won the Nobel Prize, it was an unusual year because it was October 2020, which was the beginning of COVID, pre-vaccines. And so when it came to the time that it's traditionally celebrated, which is in December 2020, all in-person celebrations were canceled, even the one that they had thought would be possible, which was up in Northern California for the California folks. So there was a last-minute rush to figure out, how do we get this done? So who do I call first when it becomes clear on a Friday night that it's canceled on for a Tuesday was Chancellor Mnookin. So we read the California shutdown rules, and she pointed out, because of course she's a lawyer, her training's a lawyer, you gotta read the rules, and that's how you problem solve. And she pointed out there was an exception for getting things filmed. You could have gatherings that were outside, and there were a certain set of restrictions. And so then we put our heads together and thought about, well, who are the parents in our kids' school that were in that industry that we could call to get the permit? So one of the things I love about Chancellor Mnookin is she's a problem solver. You know, there's no problem that is too big for her to view as an obstacle. So I really appreciated that aspect of Chancellor Mnookin over our 15 years of friendship. So I do come from a different world, not law, although there are many interesting legal aspects in astrophysics. I would never have thought of that when I was a new young professor 29 years ago. But I came to join the faculty at UCLA because UCLA owns the largest telescope in the world, which is actually very similar to the tradition here at the University of Wisconsin, which is in the 1800s. There was this push to build telescopes as universities moved into the era of becoming research universities. So the University of California and University of Wisconsin share that tradition even today in terms of their investment in big telescopes. And when I first got there, I was interested in developing new ways of using these big telescopes, and I thought I had a good idea, which is to look at the center of the galaxy and ask the very straightforward question, is there a supermassive black hole at the center of the galaxy? And the reason that's an interesting question is you want to prove that these exotic objects, which we think are fundamental elements of our universe, really do exist. For the students in the audience, I'd like to share that this first proposal was envisioned as a three-year project. This is 30 years later. We're still doing it. And it was actually turned down. It was turned down because it was a new idea for how these telescopes would be used. So people were skeptical about the technology, skeptical about what we would see. And it really gave me, led me to my favorite expression today, which is every challenge is an opportunity. Sometimes you just have to dig a little deeper in terms of finding that opportunity. In my case, it was giving talks up and down the University of California campuses to convince people outside of UCLA that, in fact, this was an interesting thing to do. So I like to start these talks out with the question, how do you observe something you can't see? That seems like an obvious question when you're trying to study a black hole, because a black hole is an object whose pull of gravity is so intense that nothing can escape it, not even light. So you can't see it directly. And what I hope to convince you is that we do have great evidence for this supermassive black hole at the center of the galaxy, and this has given us a wonderful opportunity to it going forward for using the center of our galaxy as a laboratory for understanding both the physics of black holes, in other words, how does gravity work in extreme environments, as well as the questions, astrophysical questions, of what role do these black holes play in the formation and evolution of galaxies. Okay, so to begin with, I think we have to begin with agreeing on, well, what is a black hole? Seems appropriate to put up a blank slide. because in fact, we don't have the physics to explain what a black hole is. So the way I'd like you to conceive of a black hole is a bit of a cheat, but it's actually the way I think of about black holes on an everyday basis. A black hole is an object with mass that's confined to zero volume. Okay, so if you think about density, just mass divided by volume, the density goes to infinity. And in physics, anytime something goes to infinity, it's known as a singularity, or what I like to call a giant red arrow that says, you do not have your description of the physical world correct here. and that's what makes black holes so compelling, because they represent the frontier of our knowledge. So people want to study black holes because it's an opportunity to further our understanding. So what is it from a fundamental physics perspective? What is that opportunity? Well, the limitation is that we don't know how to make the field of quantum mechanics, which is the study of things that are very small, and black holes are by definition infinitesimally small, work together with a field of general relativity, which is what Einstein is so famous for, so the description of things that have lots of gravity. So today we don't know how to bring those two fields together, and it's the hope of physics that once we understand how to make those two fields work together, that we will have the laws of physics to describe what a black hole is. In the meantime, I get to ignore this little detail that we don't, we don't know what a black hole is. The reason we can get away with this is that there is an abstract size that we can associate with a black hole. It's known as the Schwarzschild radius, and it's important for a number of reasons. One, any object with mass has a Schwarzschild radius associated with it. You, your pal, your cell phone, or anything else you'd like to turn into a black hole. And it's the radius that if you took that mass and squeezed it down to the scale of that Schwarzschild radius, gravity would overcome all other known forces and force the object to become the infinitesimally small object known as the black hole. So in a sense, the proof of a black hole lies in showing that there's a lot of mass confined within a small volume, and ideally within this well-known radius. And it just scales linearly with mass. You double the mass, you double the size. Okay, so that's the definition of a black hole and the key concepts behind proving that a black hole exists. Now, you've heard that I care about the supermassive black holes that suggest that there might be something that's not quite as big. So in astronomy and astrophysics, we actually talk about two categories of black holes, and they're wonderful demonstrations of actually the two pathways that science is often done. So the first kinds of black holes that were thought of or developed in our understanding of how astronomy works were the smaller black holes. So that they started from theoretical ideas. In other words, people who were thinking about how the most massive stars in our galaxy evolved over time would end their lives. It was recognized that those massive stars would end their lives as black holes. And fortunately, the outer layers actually explode, giving rise to a picture that we can actually see. So these are supernova. They're important in astrophysics for all sorts of other reasons. But from the point of view of this talk, the inner core of these massive stars turn into black holes. So the most massive stars in our galaxy are thought to end their lives as black holes that are roughly 10 times the mass of the sun. And this has been now demonstrated beautifully from an observational perspective, now most securely with the existence of gravitational waves. So it begins with theory, confirmed with observations. The supermassive black hole story is very different. So it doesn't start with a theoretical concept. And by supermassive, I mean a million to a billion times the mass of the sun. This story begins in the world of observations, where people saw things at the center of the galaxy that didn't make sense, and that led them to suggest the existence of supermassive black holes. Now, there's nothing in this picture that suggests the existence of a supermassive black hole. And this is a picture that's taken on a very different scale. It's taken at wavelengths that your eye detects. And if you zoom in, if you focus on the top left, there's a little spiral galaxy. So each of these things, except for one thing with the crosshair, is actually a galaxy. Each galaxy has roughly 100 billion stars. So that last picture, we were looking at a single star, so a vastly different scale. And what you're seeing in these pictures is light from typical stars, like stars that are at the same stage of evolution, roughly, as our sun. So nothing special here. So what was it that gave rise to this idea? It was actually pictures of galaxies, a small fraction of galaxies that I like to call the prima donnas of the galaxy world. They're kind of show-offs. And if you take a picture at radio wavelengths, you highlight very energetic phenomena. So coming out from the center of these galaxies, you see these massive jets, and you can figure out how fast they move. So there has to be some very powerful central engine that's giving rise to all this phenomena. And at the center, you also see light. Remember, it's not from the black hole itself, but it doesn't look like anything like stars would emit, and it was suggested that it was material just outside the Schwarzschild radius. Oh, I should have also said that's also called the event horizon, or popularized by Star Trek as the event horizon, the last point that light can escape, so you can't communicate across that boundary. But just outside the event horizon, this is the idea that there is a lot of matter gas that's feeding the black hole. It's really hot, so it shines. So you can think of it, you're seeing the feasting habits or the dining habits of a black hole. So that's lighting up these prima donnas, or as we like to call them, the active galactic nuclei, because their nuclei or centers are very active. Okay, so that is an observation that gave rise to the idea of supermassive black holes. Okay, so that's where this story starts about supermassive black holes. And in fact, that quickly led to the idea that maybe it's not this small fraction, which is roughly 10% of all galaxies have black holes, but every galaxy has a supermassive black hole. But in the common case, they're just black holes that don't have material surrounding it that can feed it. So you might call it them black holes that are on a diet or black stealth black holes, but you're just not getting any phenomena to light up what's harbored at the center of the galaxy. Okay, so this spiral galaxy that we were looking at the top left corner of that slide two slides ago is actually a galaxy that would look very much like our own if we could get outside and look back. We live about halfway out from the center of the galaxy. We're interested in asking, is there a supermassive black hole at the center of our galaxy? Almost every characteristic of a galaxy gets more extreme as you go towards the center of the galaxy. The density of stars goes up. It's about a billion times higher than where our sun resides. So I often like to think of, I describe the center of a galaxy as like a crowded, exciting urban hub, and we live out in the suburbs where things are kind of calm and slow moving. But it's an exciting place astrophysically. So it's not only the question of is there a supermassive black hole, but what is the relationship of that black hole to this environment? Our galaxy is definitely the best place to study. It's the closest center of a galaxy that we'll ever have to study. The next closest galaxy is 100 times further away, so you have the advantage of proximity. But like in life, for every pro, you usually get a con. And the problem with studying our own galaxy is that we, and living within it, our galaxy is a flattened disk-like structure. We live halfway out, so we have to look through whatever is at the through the plane of the galaxy. And it turns out not only is there a lot of stars, but there's also a lot of dust. I'm from Los Angeles. I have a very good understanding of dust in the atmosphere. The dust in our galaxy is actually just like smog. It's really good at blocking light that has a wavelength that corresponds roughly to the side of the dust. So you cannot see the center of the galaxy at optical wavelengths. A picture of our galaxy from the side of Hawaii, which is where our telescope is, and you see the plane with the light, that band of light, which is all the stars, and then running through it, you see a lack of light, and that comes from all the dust. If you go into the infrared, which is where your TV remote control works, that light has a longer wavelength and can penetrate through all the galaxy. So there are many technologies that were critical for getting this experiment off the ground, and the blossoming of infrared detectors was one key element of that story. Okay, so how do you do this? You want to look at stars that are as close to the center of the galaxy as possible, and you want to see how they move or measure how they move under the influence of gravity. I love this experiment because it's actually so simple from a physics perspective. You can explain this to a first-year physics college class. It's really, it's just the basic laws of gravity that really drive what, it's the same reason that the planets orbit the sun. So each star tells you how much mass is inside its orbit. So you get mass and you get a scale. So I want to show lots of mass inside a small volume. So you want to see the stars that are as close to the center of the galaxy as possible. In the beginning, remember I said this was a three-year project. These orbits are longer than 3 years. So it was a statistical approach. But then it turned out these orbits are at least shorter than a human lifetime. And that's actually, you have to remember how long the timescales are in astronomy. The sun takes 200 million years to go around the center of the galaxy. Something extreme has to be at the center for things to approach human timescales. Okay, so that tells you why big telescopes are so much part of this narrative. So you want to see the stars that are as close to the center of the galaxy. You want to discover the stars that are as close to the center of the galaxy. And big telescopes have two campaign promises. One is that large telescopes should see things that are very faint, and a lot of astronomy and astrophysics is driven by the desire to see things that are faint, as faint tends to correspond to things that are far away. So you get to learn about the origin of the universe and all that. I don't care about that part. I care about the fact that it's a big telescope. And the larger the telescope, in principle, the finer the detail that you can see. Okay, so if you want to see things that are close, you have to have an ability to see fine detail. All right, so why weren't people doing this before? Because there definitely has to be a hiccup. And the hiccup is that for telescopes that are on the Earth, and this is the largest telescopes at these wavelengths on the ground or in space, but on the Earth, you have to contend with the Earth's atmosphere. Great for us, it allows us to survive here on Earth, but it is a total headache for people trying to study the universe. And it's kind of profound if you think about this. This light from the center of the galaxy has been traveling to us for the last 26,000 years, and in the last 30 microseconds hits the top of the atmosphere and gets completely messed up. Okay, so I've spent a lot of my career developing and working on techniques for overcoming the blurring effects of the Earth's atmosphere. This is a nice animation that shows you the power of doing this. So going from if you don't do it, you get a big fuzzy mess, and if you do it, you actually see the stars. And in particular, where we think the center of the galaxy is in the middle of that box. It's actually a radio source to connect with what we heard about Jansky. It's one of the fainter star radio sources at the center of the galaxy, but it's a weird one. And in fact, part of the question was, is that weird radio source associated with the black hole? So we knew where to point the telescope. In other words, we were really looking towards that weird radio source. And this technology allows you, well, A, remember they said that the technique wouldn't work, so A, it does. B, you see the stars. And then C, which is the fun part, they move, and they move so fast. And this is now a fourth of the real estate of that little inset. So we've discovered thousands of stars, which is really fun. You get to name stars, and it turns out all the conventions for how you name stars don't work at the center of the galaxy because they move too fast. We probably need better names for these guys. You can probably find my favorite star in the galaxy, or for that matter, in the universe. Its name is SO2. It's trailed by a yellow line. It's my favorite star because it actually has the most power for telling you what resides at the center of the galaxy. So using these fairly straightforward laws. So, and where you infer the black hole is the location of that star. It's actually not a star, right? It's a black hole. So what have we learned? Well, we learned that when we started this work, we knew there was 4 million times the mass of the sun inside this gigantic region. It's actually about 40,000 times the Schwarzschild radius. And what has this work done is it's shown that the mass, that 4 million times the mass of the sun, is confined to a volume that's a factor of 10 million times smaller. So in other words, we've advanced the evidence for the existence of a supermassive black hole by a factor of 10 million. That's a huge number. I mean, think about anything you'd like more of in your life and advancing or getting a factor of 10 million times more. The first, remember I said there were two fundamental steps in this. The first step, the statistical approach, got us the first factor of 1,000. And the next step got us the rest of the way. Okay, so this is tremendous fun. And that's really what the Nobel Prize really is all about, is this evidence. But what's so fun about what I call technology-enabled discovery is that almost everything we've been able to look at the center of the galaxy in terms of its environment has been inconsistent with the predictions. So I like to call that either job security or being a kid in a candy shop. I actually really feel these days like the latter. And so we've got lots of things to study. Just to give you a tiny taste, there should be no young stars at the center of the galaxy. Those are the green stars, the dominant thing you see. And there's a host of other questions or things that have emerged from all of this. So there's lots more to be done, and that's what we're proceeding ahead to do. So thank you for your attention.
Andrea. And just to let you know, we will have time for questions when we are done. But to continue our story about discovery and with pertinence to black holes and centers of galaxies, I want to turn to a description of the IceCube telescope. And let me introduce.
Yeah. I need to keep going. I skipped something. Yeah.
One more. There we go. Turn things over to my colleague, Francis Halzen from the Department of Physics. Francis.
Okay, Okay, can you hear me?
Yeah.
If you give a physics professor the stage, you're going to get a physics lecture. And that's not an exception today. Look at the left panel. You see there a neutron, a proton, an electron, and a neutrino. These are the four particles that make up all matter in the universe. And you see in this arrangement, the neutron decays, falls apart into a proton and an electron. And if you went to high school, you know that if I'm the neutron and the proton and the electron move that way, there's something that conserves momentum going the other way. And people were willing in the 30s to give up energy conservation, but Pauli, who was called the conscience of physics, he refused and said there is a particle emitted there. But in the experiments, they didn't see the particle, they only saw it at missing energy. This was in the 1930s. And the idea was that's where the name ghost particle comes from. You cannot detect it. And so that's what he said. No? Okay. I'm in the right.
It's you. Is it me? Is it me?
Yeah. So, in fact, in 1996, it was detected by two American physicists. They detected neutrinos coming from a reactor. And everybody instantly realized something special about the neutrino once they realized it was real. It has no electric charge, and it has no mass. It has a small mass, but that's not important in this lecture. And so it's just like light. So you can go out at night, and instead of looking at light beams, you can go look at neutrino beams. And so that makes it an astronomical messenger. And in fact, it makes it a useful one. This is, I'm not an astronomer, but I understand this graph. And it tells you how much energy we receive from the universe at different colors of light. So in the middle somewhere, you see this high peak on the left. That's the light from the Big Bang. That dominates. That's the most light we receive from the universe. Then we move to the right to bluer and bluer colors. You see eventually you come through visible light, the light we see with our eyes. And then you go to the right of this graph, and then you see bluer and bluer light, eventually X-rays and gamma rays. Gamma rays are the highest energy astronomical messengers. And you see, we run out of luck at some point. The universe suddenly turns dark. And it is because to these high energy gamma rays, the universe starts to look opaque. And so it was immediately realized that you could study this dark universe that we have never seen, that you could study it with neutrinos. Because neutrinos, remember, they interact, they cannot be stopped. They go through the obscure universe. As a particle physicist, you know, the reason we are doing this is, and I have to be honest about this, I remember where I was when in 1991, a simple experiment in Utah detected a proton reaching us from space with 300 million TeV energy. If you don't know what TeV energy is, it's a lot. The largest accelerator in Geneva, Switzerland, makes particle beams of 7 TeV. So how can you not spend the rest of your life trying to figure out where these particles come from and how they are accelerated? In fact, in this dark universe, we detect protons. We don't see light, but we detect protons coming, including this one, with this obscenely large energy. So you build a neutrino detector, but you don't detect neutrinos with a mirror. We know how to build neutrino detectors. This is the biggest one in Japan. You need water and light sensors. But my theorist friends, in their wisdom, told me that to see neutrinos from the universe, this experiment is 10,000 times too small in volume. And so what do? You build one that's 10,000 times bigger. And here it is. So what you're looking at is, of course, fake, but it's a block of ice of a kilometer on the side below the geographic South Pole. And you see this string, and this is a string of light sensors. So we have ice and light sensors. There's one every 17 meters, and the string is a kilometer long. If you go 125 meters away, like from here to the physics department, you will see another string. And 86 of these fill a kilometer cube of ice. So now we have ice and light sensors. This block of ice is actually under the geographical South Pole below 1.4 and 2.4 kilometer depth. And so if you don't know where the South Pole is, it's there on the bottom. And it's right there, because that's where the National Science Foundation has a research station and made this project possible, also thanks to their cash. So I'll come back to this picture later. But this is how we discover we detect neutrinos. We look through the Earth. If you look up, you see all kinds of particles. But if you look through the Earth, you only see neutrinos. Only neutrinos come through the Earth. So you see this neutrino, what it will mostly do is fly through your detector. There you see the 86 strings with light sensors. But this one crashes into a nucleus. And then it makes a nuclear reaction. Remember, it changed neutrons into protons. That's nuclear physics. And when it makes a nuclear reaction, it makes charged particles. And when they travel through the ice, they emit blue light. And that blue light is what we detect. And you see these particles streaking through the ice, lighting up our light sensors. These little dots are actually one photon. And the big ones close to the track are maybe 10 to 100. Okay, here is the movie. And so you notice this with the speed of light significantly slowed down. And so you can see by eye, this one comes from 11 degrees below the horizon. So it's a neutrino. It also has a fantastic energy. It deposits 2,600 TeV, remember 7 TeV in Geneva? 600 TeV. And so it's unlikely that it's made in the atmosphere. This is a cosmic neutrino. So the important thing now is, you saw from the explanation I gave, we not only detect a neutrino, this track through the detector, it's called a muon, it actually gives us the direction where on the sky this neutrino was produced. So for 10 years, we collected a sample of 670,000 neutrinos. And I cannot show them on this map. But this actually, I won't explain what this map shows. But it shows the likelihood that somewhere in the sky, and remember, we only look at the northern sky, there is some cluster of neutrinos that have, on average, higher energy. And if you ask where the hottest spot in the sky is, it's this little box, square box. And we have two methods, actually, to look through this sky map. And both methods agree the hottest spot in the sky is this place that you see blown up on the right, and it's the active galaxy NGC 1068. We line it up with 2.1 degree, our resolution of individual events, of individual neutrinos, is only like 0.03 degrees. But so it really points at this galaxy. And this is a picture of it. And so when we studied our data, we realized that we were seeing neutrinos, but from the place we saw neutrinos, we saw no gamma rays. In fact, no astronomical experiment had ever shown any high energy emission from this galaxy. It was not known to be a cosmic accelerator before we detected the neutrinos. And so you see the blown up center where the black hole is, But that's not even where our neutrinos originate. Our data indicate, and this is easy for me to explain now, it indicates by dimensional analysis that they originate somewhere within 10 Schwarzschild radii from the black hole. And you know that's very close since the previous talk. In fact, you can stretch this to maybe 30, maybe 100, but not from this region, for instance, that the astronomers see. I had this explanation for what a Schwarzschild radius is. If you remember this picture, this is 1.5 Schwarzschild radii. So our neutrinos originate somewhere in this vicinity. You can ask, are there other sources in there? And the next two sources, the next three sources, are all active galaxies, very similar, TXSO506, PKS, etc. And NGC 4151, which I like to mention because NGC 1068 and NGC 4151 were the brightest galaxies in the sample Seifert published in 1943. So nothing is new, it's just neutrinos. Of course, it's also cosmic rays, because remember, neutrinos are connected to nuclear physics, so we are looking at proton accelerators. So we are getting a glimpse of the sources of the cosmic rays, which is one of the oldest problems in astronomy. TXSO506 looked familiar to us. We had already found it in 2017 in a very strange way. In September of 2017, we detected this neutrino. It looks, by now you know what a neutrino looks like. It has 290 TeV energy, so it's cosmic. And so what we do actually is, within 40 seconds from the light appearing in the South Pole ice, we reconstruct the direction of this neutrino and send it to all the telescopes in the world. We had no idea whether anyone paid attention. We didn't really want to know. But it turns out that at some point more than 20 telescopes were looking in the direction of this neutrino. And the interesting one actually was this, after 73 seconds, a robotic telescope was looking at it and in fact discovered an optical flash 2 hours after the neutrino was emitted. And they had been looking at the source for 15 years. It never did anything else. So you can try to explain this. So the real observation was that this was a well-known gamma ray source. It was flaring, and this galaxy also emits TV gamma rays. So all this kind of fitted together. So you published in Science, of course. But you should read the next paper, because we now knew where to look in our own data. And you see, what I've been talking about is this little red blip on the right of this plot. This is our 9.5 year of past data. And look what happened in 2014. Much more spectacular. And again, it are neutrinos from a source where no gamma rays, no other high energy radiation emerged, only seen in neutrinos. So what about, how big is this flux actually? We see from NGC 1068, we see 80 neutrinos, which is pretty miserable. But it's a start. But we see, when we look across the sky for the diffuse flux of neutrinos, we got a big surprise. You see here in blue, so this is, remember, this is where the universe cuts off in light and we want to look with neutrinos. And these are two measurements of our diffuse neutrino flux. And you see if it gives the impression that the energy reaching us in neutrinos is actually higher than the energy in electromagnetic radiation, you're right. This was a real surprise. And we have more detailed and quantitative ways of doing this. But the impression you get is that most of the energy reaching us from this dark universe is in neutrinos, is correct. In fact, this energy is so strong that we don't see our own galaxy. So something is producing, presumably these active galaxies, are producing neutrinos to the extent that they outshine the nearby sources in our own galaxy. By geometry, we should see our own galaxy first and then the rest of the universe. And you see here, I have collected these beautiful extreme events on the bottom plot. And you see our own galaxy is along the horizontal axis here. You see that's the Milky Way on the top left there. That's the universe in gamma rays. And here you see the universe in neutrinos and no sign. We actually see our own galaxy at the 10% level, but you have to squint, right? So I want to tell you for the occasion a little bit about the history of this project. As Eric said, we started thinking about this and developing this idea in 87 at the University of Wisconsin. And by 93 here, we were building the first optical sensors to be put in the ice at the South Pole. The lab actually was created by folding the ping pong table of our theory group. these people, except for Bob Bors on the left there, were theorists in their earlier life. And so these optical modules were actually deployed and worked. But if you have the impression that these people need help, you're right. And so the university set up an entity to run this project. As far as I know, this is the largest project ever attempted by a single university. And you must appreciate, this was at a time that very few people would have bet their wallet on this. And so we had to solve three major problems. The next question you may actually ask, why did this take 30 years? Well, we had to solve three major problems. We had to learn to look through the atmosphere. The atmosphere produced neutrinos. It's very much the story you heard before. And the problem with us is the clouds never go away. And so we had to first figure out how to extract. You know, we see about one atmospheric neutrino every 4 minutes. And the type of pictures I showed you, we see an event like that once a month. So that's the problem we solved. The second problem was that you have to put these sensors in the ice. That's obviously a big problem. And we figured out how to do this. It's now called hot water drilling. This was developed here in collaboration with Space Science and Engineering Center and the Physical Sciences Laboratory in Stoughton, where the detector was built. Not only the detector, that was the easy part. It was to build the drilling system, which is a 4.8 megawatt heating plant, which has to go to the pole. And then you have to melt the ice in a reasonable time, 2 days. Over 2.5 kilometers. And that sole problem was that challenge we met as well. So the challenges of this project have been met. We now actually, if we build a detector now, we would actually know what we were doing and would be able to optimize it. And of course, we have already done that. And so we have the design of a new detector. And it will be 10 times bigger, and we are going to build it. Thank you.
Thank you, Francis. Now let's shift gears just a little bit in this journey of discovery. And you've heard a little bit about the past, a little bit of things we are working on now. But let's think about possibly, and I'm not going to make any promises, and I don't think Susanna will either.
Nope.
what could be a next great discovery that changes the way we think about ourselves and our place in the universe? And for that story, we turn it over to Susanna Widicus Weaver.
Thank you, Eric, for the introduction, and congratulations, Chancellor Mukin. We're very happy to have you here. So I'm Susanna Widicus Weaver. I'm in both the chemistry and astronomy departments here at UW-Madison, and I'm interested in questions related to the origin of life, and I study that through studying laboratory chemistry and then looking for molecules in space. So I joke that I don't look at little green men, I look at little green molecules. But the question I try to answer is, what does the chemistry of space tell us about the potential for life in the universe? So everyone's heard about the recent launch of the James Webb Space Telescope, hopefully. James Webb launched on Christmas Day a year and a half ago. It is an infrared observatory that gives us a new look at the universe, and this was one of the very first images released from the James Webb Telescope. This is the Carina Nebula. Interstellar clouds, the stuff between the stars in space, are much like clouds on Earth, but they're much less dense. And so this is a beautiful image of the dust in one of these clouds. And within these regions, you actually have these little clumps of gas and dust, and those are the regions where new stars form, and those are the regions where new planets are forming. And so the question we're trying to answer is, if we look at these regions of star and planet formation, how can we use the chemistry to understand how life might evolve in the universe? So if you look at the star and planet formation big picture, you start off with one of these interstellar clouds. Eventually, that gravitationally collapses down into a new star. It's embedded in the gas and dust from the original cloud. We actually now have evidence that a lot of the molecules survive that process and get incorporated into that new solar system. Eventually, planets start to form, and they orbit around that central star, and then eventually you end up with a solar system like ours. And so as we watch the chemistry, as we go from interstellar clouds to new stars to planet-forming zones to a solar system like ours, what we find is the chemistry actually becomes more terrestrial-like as we go through that process. And so my group actually looks at this process and tries to understand how the chemistry changes as we go through those phases of star formation. So the really important link here is, even today here on Earth, the chemistry from our solar system changes the chemistry that we see on Earth. So we now think that a large portion of the water on early Earth and much of the organic molecules that eventually became biological systems on Earth were delivered to Earth from impact, from the debris as Earth was forming and going around the sun. And so we know this because we still see meteor showers on Earth. We can go out and collect meteorite samples. This is one of the most famous ones. This is the Murchison meteorite. It fell in Australia. It is a special type of meteorite because it's a carbonaceous chondrite. And we know from dating and other experiments of the material in this that it contains some of the earliest pieces of our solar system. It also contains more amino acids than we use in biology on Earth. It contains sugars. It contains all sorts of molecules that biology uses. And all of that came in on this meteorite from our solar system and was delivered to Earth's surface. So we can go out, actually, you can do upper atmospheric flights and collect interplanetary dust particles that are hitting our atmosphere and delivering material constantly to the surface of Earth. So we think that the ingredients of life actually came from the solar system when Earth was forming, and that more material is constantly bombarding Earth and being delivered to our system here on Earth. So meteorites are great because you can go out and pick them up and analyze them. You can take them to your lab and you can do experiments and find out exactly what is in there. But if we want to trace the early phases of star and planet formation, we have to have the information available to be able to guide observations with telescopes. So this particular image kind of revolutionized the field of astrochemistry, certainly, and the field of planet formation. This is an image from the ALMA Observatory in Chile. It is actually a high spatial resolution image and a high spectral resolution image. And what it is a planet-forming disk. So that stage of star formation where things are still falling in on the star, planets are just starting to form, and you have kind of this pancake of material around the new star. If you look at one of those disks with ALMA, you can actually see gaps in the dust around that star. And those rings are there because there are new planets forming in those gaps. It's very difficult to observe the planet directly, but we're getting to the point now where we can actually use the distribution of material in the disk to back out where the planets might be hidden in the dust in one of these planet-forming regions. And so we can trace where the planets are forming. We can trace where the chemistry changes, which tells us something about what type of planet it might be. And we can put this all together and come up with a chemical scenario of what ingredients might be available as that planet is starting to form. Now, if we take this one step further, one of the beautiful aspects of the James Webb Space Telescope is going to be that we can directly start to measure the chemistry in the atmospheres of planets outside of our solar system. So an exoplanet is a planet outside of our solar system, and we have now identified over 5,000 exoplanets over the last, say, 20, 30 years. And if you look in the region where there might be liquid water at the surface of the planet, that is what we define as the habitable zone. So those are the zones within a new solar system where life might be present because there's liquid water accessible at the surface. Earth, of course, in our solar system is neatly in the habitable zone. Mars and Venus are at the edges of the habitable zone in our solar system. So we're looking for Earth-like planets, basically. Planets that might be rocky and might have liquid water at the surface. Of the 5,000 or so exoplanets that have been detected, about 60 right now are in the range of potentially habitable planets. And so there's this huge effort in the field to start taking measurements of the molecules in the atmospheres of these planets and hunting for planets whose atmospheres look like Earth, because life has a very distinct signature when you look at the atmosphere. And so there are ongoing efforts with some of my colleagues in the astronomy department in trying to understand the what we call biosignatures in these planets and trying to link that chemistry to the planet-forming disk back to the original star-forming region embedded within the cloud. My particular research looks at how complex chemistry can form in space and how far can it go, how do the different physical conditions of these regions affect the chemistry that we see, and where along that evolutionary process in astrophysics can we see something biologically relevant? So I show here glycine. Can you make glycine out in space? Or do you need a planet with water and condensed phase chemistry for that sort of molecule to form? Glycine is the simplest amino acid used in life on Earth. And so it's kind of the holy grail of astrochemistry looking for new molecules in space. We've found glycine in meteorites and in comets, but it's never been definitively found in interstellar space before. So we have a lot of questions about the chemistry and how we build up to things like sugars and amino acids, nucleobases, all the things we need to be able to build cells and to build life like we know it on Earth. So my group, as I said, does a combination of laboratory work and observations. We have a beautiful brand new lab in Chamberlain Hall. I moved here in 2020 in the middle of the pandemic, and so this has been a bit of a transition, but we're very excited to be here. We do a lot of really creative, weird things to molecules in my lab to make things we can't buy in a bottle. So we light things up with lasers, we light things up in plasma discharges, and we try to take these spectral fingerprints of molecules And so once we have a spectrum, we know it is unique to that particular molecule. And I show that here. Here's methanol. Here's glycolaldehyde, the simplest sugar-related species. We can compare these to telescope observations, and we can try to identify all the molecules that might be out there in space. So we do this by going to various observatories around the world. I show here our most recent observations. This is using the NOAEMA telescope, which is in the French Alps. UW is a partner in the NOAEMA collaboration, and so we have a dedicated amount of time per year for scientists here to be able to use the NOAEMA Observatory. And my group is using this to look at these star-forming cores right before the disk starts to form, so before there are planets, to try to understand that transition of the of the chemistry as the star starts to form. So we actually have here two embedded star-forming regions in a region called W3. They're right next to each other, but they're different ages. So the assumption we're making is the cloud is the same that they were both born from. And we're trying to see how the chemistry is different when you look at it at different evolutionary stages. So we can make these beautiful maps, really high resolution maps, of molecules in these cores. And then we can zoom in and we can look at the detail of different types of chemistry as we look at these cores. And so if we look at this core here on the right, we take a spectrum. Each one of these spikes is a line from a particular molecule. And then we can image that around the source and see what it tells us about which molecules are in which core, what temperatures they are, what densities they are, and structurally what's going on within this core. The map that I show here on the bottom right is actually this right core where there is an embedded region that's fairly evolved for a new star, and a disk is just starting to form. And we actually see for the first time organic molecules embedded in that, they call it a dusty cocoon, of this new star-forming region. And so we're really excited to keep probing this region because we think if we can start extrapolating from this simple organic chemistry that we may be able to see some of the ingredients of biology as we know it on Earth forming in these star-forming regions. UW has really done amazing things in the last few years in helping me get set up, but also in promoting this origin of life theme in research. So shortly after I got here, we were approved for a cluster hire where we hired three colleagues in origin of life research. Batul Kachar is in bacteriology. She studies ancient DNA and molecular astrobiology. Zoe Todd is coming this summer. She's going to be in chemistry and astronomy. She studies the delivery of organic molecules to planetary surfaces as they're forming. And then Thomas Beatty in astronomy is our biosignatures with James Webb and exoplanets guy. Every time I sit next to Thomas at a meeting, I sneak a peek at what's on his computer screen because it's always new. we have these amazing colleagues coming in. We have a lot of people on campus who have kind of 1 foot in the origin of life research area. Some people have 2 feet in it. So we're all coming together now around these cluster hires and forming new collaborations and pushing ahead into this new frontier of astronomy. The first exoplanet was only detected a few decades ago. So we've come a long way in that period of time, and the field is just opening up with new research ideas. So it's a really exciting time. We're starting a new center here at UW, which we call WICOR, the Wisconsin Center for Origins Research. We have space in the astronomy department that will be dedicated to collaborative space, seminar rooms, all of those sorts of things. We have 7 departments that want to be involved in this, and if you're in another department not on this list, we are always looking for more partners. But the idea is to bridge all the way from astrophysics and origin of planets and stars all the way through to evolutionary biology. So can we get people with the expertise to be able to look at this entire picture of origin of life type questions? So we're bringing together this team, and these are the kind of the big picture questions we hope to answer someday. As Eric said, I won't commit that we will be able to answer them, but we're going to try. So do other worlds offer habitable environments? Is Earth the only life-supporting planet in the universe? I would venture to guess the answer to the first one is yes, and the second one is no. I think we know enough we can say that now. How did life form on early Earth? We don't know, but we have ideas. And then how did complex life evolve? How do we go from very simple single-celled organisms all the way up to humans and the animals and the array of biology that we see today? So our hope is with this interdisciplinary team under the YCOR umbrella here at UW, we can start to try to answer these very fundamental questions. So with that, I'll stop and thank you for your attention and turn things back over to Eric.
Thank you, Susanna. Thank you to all our speakers. And I hope you've gotten a sense over this past little over an hour of the amazing sense of what discovery is all about. And the people involved in that discovery, and it is a very human endeavor, and you've gotten a sense of that this afternoon. So join me in a round of applause for thanking our three panelists once again. And while I have questions for them, I do want to open it up to the audience to see if you have any questions for our panelists. And don't be shy. Well, yeah.
I was wondering.
Well, we're trying to get a microphone here.
With the last speaker, you said there's time when you get to go to Norma?
Noema.
Noema?
Yes.
Do they also get to come? Do they come to Madison?
So we have joint seminars where we collaborate with them online via Zoom. We are in constant communication with their staff scientists because they help our students learn how to handle the data reduction for our observations, and then we send people there to visit. Yeah, I volunteer. The French Alps is pretty amazing.
Yes.
I'm just wondering, when you're searching for what you call life, you didn't offer a definition of life, so everything you're searching for is based on life as we know it on Earth. How do you know there can't be other forms of life that are completely inconsistent with what we understand biological life to be?
We don't know that. We actually, in our group that we're forming, we're trying to get outside of that confined definition of life. Certainly, we want to study how life evolved on Earth, but we want to look at other possibilities. The big challenge in that is you open up this wealth of chemical avenues that you can explore, and so you have to make very informed decisions based on the environments and the exoplanets where we think it might be habitable. But under the formal definition of habitability, the only requirement is liquid water.
Do we have another? Oh, wait. Go ahead. Got a microphone coming.
I've also heard that magnetic fields are very important for life. That is protecting the surface, from cosmic radiation. Say, do your chemical signatures give some measurement of a magnetic field in these exoplanets?
No, that's not something we can measure from the molecules, but that's certainly one area to consider. There are a lot of open questions about Earth's form of biology and why things ended up the way they did. So that would be one thing to consider.
For the last speaker, when clouds form stars and planets, could these clouds be other than carbon dense, leading to other than carbon based life forms?
So we know that the dust in the interstellar medium is made up of silicates, like sand on Earth, and also carbonaceous material. So there are different types of dust, and we can tell those apart through observations. Most of the dust is either silicates or carbon-based. And so based on that, we assume that carbon is a major ingredient. By and large, in the universe, hydrogen is the dominant element. But in terms of constructing bodies, carbon seems to be very important.
Susanna, So the, the photographs of the galaxies all look like they are a vortex of one sort or the other, spinning one direction or the other. Have you looked to see whether these vortexes are all left-handed or right-handed? And if not, I think it might be interesting to see.
Andrea, I think it might be for you.
You know, the fact that they look like there's rotation comes from just the simple conservation of angular momentum. So it's really hard. And all these things start as really big structures with just tiny, tiny bits of rotation. So it's really just a consequence of angular momentum conservation.
You know, in this context, it's actually strange that the word dark matter has never been mentioned.
It's true.
But it's all over these pictures, as you probably know, right? And so that's one problem that we have not been able to resolve or even come close to resolving, except for gravity, of course.
How do you consider multi-star systems when you're searching for life? Because, like, there are planets that can exist in, like, systems with two or three stars, and I know that those orbits aren't always the steadiest or stablest. So how do you consider those if they are relatively similar to Earth's size and conditions?
So I don't know of a system off the top of my head where we've found Earth-like exoplanets in a situation like that. I think in terms of the conditions for life, the big question in my mind would be, what does the radiation from two stars do to the surface properties of the planet? You know, does it destroy the molecules? Does it drive the chemistry to more complex chemistry? Is the water liquid or frozen? So those are the first questions that I would ask. And then beyond that, I'm not sure. You would probably have to run a model of that system to see what the influence would be.
Let's take one more.
Yep. Hi, I would like to ask, how are supermassive black holes formed?
Oh, great question. And in fact, the thinking about that has evolved a lot over the last few decades. So actually, when we started our work, people used to ask which came first, the black hole or the galaxy. It was a bit like the chicken or the egg question. We had lots of ways of invoking one pathway or the other. But what has emerged over the last decade or so is that the mass of these supermassive black holes seems to correlate incredibly well with the central part of the galaxy, which is so much larger. That gives rise to the concept that they actually had to form synergistically. They had to form together. And that there's some feedback mechanism that keeps the growth of the two things, the host galaxy and the supermassive black hole, in lock sync. So that really gives you a picture that in the early universe, when there was lots of dark matter, gives you these density fluctuations, and you get the collapse of this object that both forms the galaxy itself and then this very condensed, high-density object at the middle that we call the supermassive black hole.
So one of the great things about Investiture is that it's not just a celebration of our new leader, but also an opportunity to think about the university and the future of the university. And so in that vein, I want to ask each of you in your disciplines to think about what your discipline will look like when our university celebrates its 200th birthday in 25 years. So if you look ahead, what will your disciplines look like 25 years from now? Andrea, we'll start with you.
Okay, well, I think, astronomy as a whole, and we're incredibly lucky because there's so much evolution in technology. We're in this rapid growth phase. And in fact, there's a tremendous amount of instrumentation that's being developed around, that will allow us much better understanding of supermassive black holes. So one of the most exciting things that has happened in the last decade has been the success of gravitational wave detectors here on Earth, which are sensitive to stellar mass black holes, the little ones. And I don't know if I'm right about this, unless scale's right, but what we're developing today is the ability to detect gravitational waves from space, where the baseline is so much larger that we'll be able to detect the mergers of supermassive black holes, which are inevitable if you believe that supermassive black holes exist at the center of galaxies, because galaxies collide. So I think that's one example that I hope we are where we are.
Thank you. Francis.
Yeah, the short answer to the question is UW will still be the leader.
That's the right answer.
Don't get complacent. Actually, you know, if you look at the development of radio telescopes, it went actually by today's standards very slowly. Mm. And so I hope this is not a model for neutrino astronomy. At the moment, they are building a detector that should achieve the size and the sensitivity of IceCube in the Mediterranean Sea. You realize you need some big object that has nice optical properties, and you can find that deep in the ocean. In fact, that was the original idea that goes back to the 1960s. And so there is also a detector being constructed, it's half finished, in Lake Baikal. There are three projects in the Atlantic Ocean, one in off the coast of Canada, again a project to build a detector like IceCube, two in China, with one, if I remember well, a project that promises deploying 3,000 strings. And so it will be, it will also be 10 times IceCube. So, and I'm sure there are more to come. So, as I said, we shouldn't become complacent. But that's good.
Yeah.
I think certainly we're in the middle of the exoplanet revolution right now, and I think within the next few decades we will definitively identify many exoplanets that are Earth-like and potentially habitable. I won't say that we'll find life in the universe, but maybe. but I'm also really excited about some upcoming planetary science missions. Did they launch JUICE today? Gustavo's here. Did it launch? You haven't seen, it's launching today. So they're sending solar system missions to many of the moons in our outer solar system where the giant planets certainly aren't habitable, but their moons may be. And so we're getting ready to explore moons of Jupiter and Saturn that have water ice at the surface, but clearly liquid readily accessible just beneath the surface. And so it may be that we find more habitable environments in our solar system than we currently know about. And so those missions are in progress, and I hope JUICE launched today successfully.
It was delayed?
Okay. So JUICE is going to Ganymede, and then in a few years we have Europa Clipper going up as well, and I think those experiments will tell us a lot about the potential for life elsewhere in our solar system and the universe.
Great. Thank you. Well, thank you all for spending an hour and a half with us this afternoon. Let's one more time thank our panelists. And of course, let's congratulate Chancellor Mnookin on the occasion of her induction. Thank you. Have a great rest of your day.